actually quite influential in covering negotiations for both the 94 agreed framework and the six-party talks, David Sanger from the New York Times. So at this point, I'm going to thank all the panelists for coming and turn it over to David.
Well, thank you, Victor, and thank all of you for coming here, and thanks to CSIS. But as Victor has suggested, we actually do have an all-star panel here, and pleased to say that they are all good friends. And I'll stipulate at the beginning, none of you have ever talked to the New York Times for a newspaper story, okay? So we'll have that straight up, right? So let me just do a very quick introduction, because for this crowd, you all know each of them, but Youngwoo Chun, who's down at the other end of the stage from me here, is the chairman and founder of the Korean Peninsula Future Forum. And he, of course, was the national security advisor under President Lee from 2010 to 2013, a particularly active time in all of this. Sitting next to him, Steve Bosworth, who's now a senior fellow at the Belfort Center of Science and International Affairs at the Kennedy School, and is chairman of the U.S. Korea Institute at the Johns Hopkins Nitze School, and of course was dean of the Fletcher School of Law and Diplomacy. But because that job wasn't a busy enough one, he decided that he would take on a part-time gig at the time as the Obama administration's main envoy for dealing with the North Koreans, something that made running Fletcher look easy, right, Steve? Bob Gallucci, distinguished professor in practice of diplomacy at the School of Foreign Service at Georgetown. He, of course, was the dean of the school for 13 years and was the president of the MacArthur Foundation in Chicago. And he was the special envoy who dealt with the North Koreans during the 1994 crisis. It was, I think, the time when we first met and did a lot of business together. And then, of course, immediately to my left is Chris Hill, who's the dean of the Corbell School of International Studies at the University of Denver. And prior to that, he was an ambassador, of course, to Iraq, to Korea, and also ran the talks with North Korea that took place in the second half of the Bush administration, about which he has written a lot. I've written a fair bit about his time there. Anybody who wanted to see interesting interchanges, you should go read up on the interchanges between Chris Hill and Vice President Cheney. They're some of the most entertaining dialogues back and forth in recent American governmental history. So let me start first with you, Ambassador Chun. So we heard Rich Armitage at the last session say, you know, I'm not sure the North Koreans really want to go deal with us very much. And by us, I think he meant with the United States directly, or at least don't want to deal with them as much as perhaps Kim Jong-un's father did and grandfather did, that they're on a different agenda and that they are pursuing more of a campaign of terror that would suggest perhaps a at least an internal concern about how well the regime can hold together in a way that we haven't seen before. So my opening question is, do you agree with Mr. Armitage's analysis? And what can you tell us about what you think is different about the way Kim Jong-un is handling both the country and the nuclear issue?
Well, I wouldn't say that Kim Jong-un is not interested in talks. I think the problem is that the talks that he envisages would not be acceptable to the rest of the six-party partners. So I think the talks, the terms of the talks that he has in mind are not acceptable to us. I think he wants talks on the premise that he doesn't have to denuclearize. He may be interested in capping North Korea's nuclear capabilities in exchange for political, economic rewards. So I don't think we can resume that kind of talks with North Korea on North Korean terms. So it's about the terms and conditions of resumption of the talks, not about talks themselves. So if it is talks, you know, on the assumption that North Korea doesn't have to denuclearize, that would end up legitimizing North Korea's nuclear armament. That's, I think, not better than no talks at all, in my view.
And what does that tell you about the stability of the regime?
Well, today? we have been hearing. Mm-hmm. You have more to say?
No, I was just going to.
Well, we have been hearing some horror stories about executions of the latest executions about former defense minister and senior officials in North Korea. So that would give us impression that the regime is unstable. I think we have to guard against quick judgment about that. What that means to me is that Kim Jong-un doesn't have much tolerance for dissenting views of his colleagues in the Politburo, and he may not like the unsolicited advice about how he should conduct business in the country, but I wouldn't conclude that the regime itself is shaky because of the some sexy headlines that we have read. But I think if he continues to execute those who he would deem as disloyal or disrespectful about his leadership, then he would push the senior power elites into a coalition against him. That would be a very dangerous thing. He is taking chance, but I wouldn't underestimate that he is in firm control of the key veins of power. But in the long run, I wouldn't believe that the regime will be stable. But I think the most important game he's playing is with the Byungjin policy. It's a two-track policy of economic development and nuclear armament. And what concerns me is he's making progress. I think we don't have to dismiss him. I think he may be making progress because of weak sanctions in place, the sanctions which do not really bite North Korea. So he's not really paying much price for nuclear armament. And he's moving full speed ahead without impediments to building operational nuclear arsenal and with a more sophisticated means of delivery. So this is something that we have to watch out, and I think we shouldn't lose sight of the bigger picture because of the persecutions, the purges, executions that we hear from North Korea.
So Steve, you're no longer paid to defend the administration's policy on all of this, but I'll press in that direction anyway. So we hear from Ambassador Chun that North Korea is not really paying much of a price for its nuclear development. The last set of sanctions we saw put on the North were in early January in response to the Sony attack. Wasn't really nuclear related, but it was an effort to try to trim their sails on another form of possible aggression of the United States and allies. And yet when you compare the sanctions regime for North Korea to say what the administration has done so publicly and so aggressively with Iran, it would lead you to a conclusion that the administration's significantly more serious about the Iranian problem than they are about actually changing behavior in North Korea. Is that an unfair assessment?
No.
What I've always loved about Steve is he's a man of few words out here. Tell us why.
Well, I was sitting living in New York in 1994, minding my own business, when the gentleman on my right and his co-conspirator in the front row, Bob and Tom, came to me and persuaded me, and I don't quite know how even now, to leave that comfortable existence running a small foundation and take on the task of organizing the Korean Energy Development Organization and running it for a brief period of time.
The lesson from which we're supposed to is never return Gallucci's phone calls?
Exactly.
Yeah, right.
Exactly.
Too late.
And that's 20 years ago, 21 years now. And I think, charitably, one could argue there were two brief periods of success in U.S. strategy toward North Korea in that long period of time. First was in the immediate aftermath of the agreed framework and the Cato implementation process. I think there were opportunities there that for various reasons we were unable to take advantage of. North Korea was not trying to take full advantage of them, but there was a potential. Second period was when Chris was engaged in the six-party talks, 2005, and for a brief period after that, when I think there were opportunities. And to give Chris full credit, I think he managed to implement or take advantage of most of those opportunities. Other than that, including my own period of service as special representative, I think the history of American policy toward North Korea has been one of pretty much unrelenting failure. And that's a harsh judgment to make, and I don't ascribe all of the blame for that to, by any means, to the United States. The principal villain on the Korean Peninsula is, after all, North Korea. And that's a basic reality. But none of us walk away from those 20 years of engagement with medals of commendation for what, as national policies, we've managed to achieve.
And to the initial question of what is it that makes the Obama administration, from your discussions with them in the first term, feel, as it seems to me, that this is a problem that they have to sort of look at in the rearview mirror, that certainly the test that took place, the nuclear test that took place shortly after the president was inaugurated, seemed to turn many people who might have been interested in engagement in the White House into sort of North Korea hawks. But tell us why they seem to be stuck between not wanting to engage that much, but also not wanting to do the kind of organized sanctions regime we've seen in the Iran case.
Well, first of all, I don't think North Korea is nearly as vulnerable to that kind of sanctions regime as Iran was. Mm-hmm. Iran had a significant, although not huge, middle class, which was actively engaged with the outside world. Iran was in many ways similar to South Africa in the 80s. North Korea did not have that. Now, some of our sanctions have hurt them, without question, but it is not the kind of measure that you can apply, as we did in the case of Iran, and cause, within a relatively brief period of time, desire for change in the underlying circumstances.
Bob, as you think back to the 94 period, you went forward to that, which I think, as Steve's pointed out, was one of the hopeful moments when we had the framework together. And you then compare it, you speed forward 20 years to today. Tell us what lessons that emerge from the framework agreement you think we might be able to apply, if any, to the current circumstance.
Do you have another question?
I do, but you're going to have to get it from Chris. It'll be worse than mine.
I think we worked on an assumption in 1993-94 that there might be, could be, an intersection in our interests and North Korean interests. You know, we had a model we applied to North Korea to answer the question, why did they want to have a nuclear weapons program? And it was a simple model. They wanted to have a nuclear weapons program, probably in order to prevent regime change from being imposed upon them by the United States as the sole remaining superpower at that point in the early 90s, and in order to preserve their own survival. And possibly also They wanted to have nuclear weapons so that they might eventually use them to still the United States and essentially break the alliance so that they could unify the peninsula under force of arms. So it was a simple model, and it was that the nuclear weapons had to do with either an offensive or a defensive posture. And the idea was, if we could we have a negotiation with North Korea that met its objectives, not the offensive one, but the defensive one? Could we have a relationship with that for them, a political relationship that removed the threat they might, or we presume they perceived from the United States and the Republic of Korea? That's what we were thinking. We didn't know, but that's what we were thinking. That, by the way, in terms of lessons, is still what I think we're thinking, because we actually don't know what the North Koreans were thinking then or are thinking now. The proposition that the North Koreans will not give up their nuclear weapons program, and therefore, as Ambassador said, I think quite precisely, we should not negotiate with them unless the nuclear weapons program is on the table to be given up, is, in my view, correct, for the reason that were we to do otherwise, we would be legitimizing that program, as you said. So I share that view. It's a view we had in 94. I think it's still a correct view. I don't know of any conclusions that we have reached through the crisis period, but he can talk about that, that revises the basic structure of what we were trying to do and what assumptions we were making while we were doing it. The assumptions didn't mean then, in the 2000s or now, that we absolutely know what motivates the North Koreans, but the idea is let's explore and see if we can find that point. That still seems to me that's a lesson that it's worth doing. I think another lesson is that once you succeed at that to whatever degree, you cannot walk away. I thought that was a very kind way that my colleague to my left characterized what didn't happen after the agreed framework in 1994. Much greater attention should have been paid, I think, in retrospect, to curating that arrangement. That's another lesson.
The implementation of it, making sure Congress delivered what they said they would, what the U.S. had committed to deliver.
If we were right about what the North Koreans expected from the framework, namely that it would create a political relationship with the United States, which would leave them in no longer in need of nuclear weapons as a method of dealing with the possible threat from the United States, we did not do that. Mm-hmm. Certain things happened, and both on the side of a new Republican Congress and on the side of a Democratic administration that had other things on its mind. So that's another lesson from this, and maybe I should stop there.
Well, Chris, you've just heard from Bob. He left the situation perfectly well organized for you when you came in. I can't imagine how it is that you had so much trouble dealing with these guys at that time. But I'm wondering if you take us up through the Bush administration's time. You had a first term in which, as Bob just described, in the Bush administration, they essentially walked away from a program that the North Koreans were, as we now know, cheating on with the uranium enrichment program. By the second term, by the second part of President Bush's term, you came in with that group of people who believe that the first rule of holes is stop digging one. And you started up a negotiation that ultimately resulted in what turned out to be some dismantlement, but reversible dismantlement, as we've seen. Tell us a little bit about what you think the lessons from that period are that we should be drawing for right now.
Well, I think any administration wants to look at the activities of a previous administration, and I can certainly respect the idea that, you know, they didn't want to continue with a framework agreement, whatever. The problem was they didn't replace it with anything. So we went for arguably 4 years without anything in its place. And, framework agreement became a sort of term you couldn't even use, within meetings in the Bush administration. But frankly, it was a process whereby we got a handle on North Korea's nuclear program. It was absolutely, in my opinion, the right thing to do. And if you're going to change it, you better replace it with something else. And that wasn't done. So first rule is if you're going to discontinue something, you better think in terms of what you're going to put in its place. So then along came the six-party talks. And I think it was the right approach. After all, it's not just an American problem. It's a problem for the entire region. And coming as I came from the Republic of Korea, where I'd been ambassador, and you know, Steve talks about being happy in New York. I was happy in Seoul. I mean, and so being asked to do this, I came with the context and the timing that this North Korean issue was creating big problems in the U.S. South Korean relationship, big problems that I found very worrisome, because I feel our most important relationship there is not North Korea, it's obviously the Republic of Korea. And so I thought it was very important to re-engage in a partnership with other parties, especially South Korea. Steve said some nice comments about my role in the six parties, but I worked with others, especially Chun Young-woo, together. I mean, we nailed a few issues. And basically, the strategy was, as you suggest, when you see a hole, stop digging. But when you see something that requires immediate attention, do something about it. And so the first thing we did was the idea to shut down the plutonium program. Plutonium was, after all, the material from which they're making bombs. It did not mean that we didn't believe that there might well be a uranium enrichment program. In fact, there was a lot of evidence which was consistent with the idea there was a uranium enrichment program. So quite simply, we wanted to shut down the plutonium program and keep the door open to further explanation on the uranium enrichment program. So every time I talked about plutonium, people would say, well, why aren't we doing anything on the uranium enrichment? Sort of like, when I wear a yellow tie, my wife says, what's wrong with a red tie? I mean, you've got to do something, and it doesn't mean you can do everything at the same time, but we certainly were not prepared to just sort of forget about the uranium enrichment program. We knew that was an issue. So what we hoped was to stop the bomb-making material. And then secondly, by a series of small steps, get the North Koreans to follow along in this in the process. This idea that they were to fall out of bed one morning and make a sort of strategic decision to do away with all their nuclear weapons, I just didn't see that happening. Strategic decisions are fairly rare in the world. So mostly what you do is you kind of edge people in the right direction and they feel that the world hasn't collapsed because I've moved a few inches this way, so I'll continue to do that. So that was kind of the day-to-day strategy. And it was especially important to get the U.S. government behind this. As your opening comments suggested, I'm not sure we ever got the vice president behind the president's program. I'll leave that up to the vice president or the former vice president and the former president to sort out.
He was pretty clear in his memoirs on that issue, as I recall.
Yes, he certainly contained his enthusiasm for just about everything we were doing. But we got a national security staff. I mean, Victor Cha was very instrumental in kind of convincing others within the National Security Council to test these assumptions that maybe we can make progress. But Victor also understood that losing this relationship with South Korea or seeing this relationship diverge was also very deleterious to our regional interests. So we worked very hard on that. At the end of the day, the issue ended, the negotiations ended, not because we didn't want to continue, but rather North Korea never gave us the verification that we required. So when they gave us a declaration, frankly, I didn't care what they were going to say in their declaration. What was important was whether we could verify things that we were concerned about. And they essentially gave us a verification regime that allowed us to verify things that we already knew. So we had to stop going forward on the basis of the fact that we did not have a verification process. Now, maybe with a normal country, and I do not put North Korea into that category, you could sort of begin with a verification process and then kind of widen the scope of it and eventually have the verification you needed. But it was pretty clear the North Koreans had no intention of allowing us to verify suspected sites. They used the stuff about Iraq at the time. They said, you just wanted to look at Saddam Hussein's palaces, but then they denied having any palaces of their own. So, and certainly we're not prepared to allow us to verify. And that's where it all ended. So was it right to get into a negotiation on an incremental basis and try to push it as far as you could? Absolutely, because I think today, the ROK-U.S. relationship is in pretty good shape, and I think overall the U.S. did well in the region for having tried.
Steve Gibson.
Just a brief note to history. What happened in 2009, 2010? Why was the Obama administration not able to engage, which was, I would say, in the opening several months, was the overwhelming sentiment within the administration. We really wanted to try to restore the momentum that Chris and the Bush administration had gained in the period of 2005 on. Why not? Why didn't it happen? It wasn't because of our lack of sincerity, if you will. It was largely because, I think in retrospect, because of the internal situation in North Korea. Even then, they were going through a transition of leadership. Kim Jong-il had been visibly ill since 2008. They were clearly preparing the ground for succession on the part of Kim Jong-un. And I think in retrospect, clearer to me than it was certainly at the time, there was a predisposition on the part of North Korea to make sure everybody understood that the United States was the enemy, that there was no possibility for compromise. Hence, President Obama greeted them in effect with his open hand. And as I've cited before, they basically extended their middle finger. And they then had a missile test, they had a nuclear test, they did all sorts of stuff, I think in retrospect, designed to buttress the regime as it went through this very difficult transition, which, as far as we know, may still be underway.
Ambassador Chun, when you were in office as National Security Advisor during this time, you were famously engaged in some conversations, as the U.S. had been previously, with the Chinese on how you go handle the North Koreans. And we read probably more about that than you would care for us to have all read, thanks to the WikiLeaks revelations. But in the course of those discussions, it certainly seemed as if it was South Korea's view that China could be peeled away to some degree from the North Koreans. And if you look at what's happened since Kim Jong-un came in, I would say that the relationship with the Chinese and the North Koreans has turned from frosty to frostier. I mean, he has still not, he's been in office for over 2 years now, he's still not made a trip to China. And the Chinese don't seem to be extraordinarily eager to go deal with him. A few years ago, we would have thought this was great news. But it doesn't seem to have made that big a difference. So give us your analysis of what's going on.
Well, we never have enough information about North Korea to make an informed judgment. That's, we are all trying to make an educated guess on North Korea-China relations. Actually, I have been continuing my discussions with Chinese even after I retired. And I think there has been a lot of a change in China's rhetoric, attitude toward North Korea. But I see no basis to, no ground to conclude that China's fundamental policy toward North Korea is changing or is likely to change anytime soon. They are tougher toward North Korea, and they are trying to be more emphatic in pushing North Korea into denuclearization. But I don't think they are willing to use any of the leverage they have to push North Korea into denuclearization. So I think they are giving more effusive lip service to the virtues of denuclearization. That would be how I would describe China's position now. But I'm not seeing their harsh language translating into real action to change North Korea's behavior, change North Korea's policy. So I don't think that will change anytime soon with North Korea.
Anybody here on that point?
Yeah, I'd just like to comment. I agree with that. I think China has not made fundamental or strategic decisions on North Korea. At the same time, there is a difference in the way Chinese talk about North Korea. It is very clear that if you took a snapshot today of Chinese attitudes to North Korea and a snapshot 10 years ago, 20 years ago, big difference. I think more importantly, there's a big difference between the way China considers the Republic of Korea today and 10 years ago. And I think China is gradually coming around to the view that the Republic of Korea is a good neighbor, can be a good neighbor for China. And I think the quality of the summits they've had, the quality of the dialogue between the Republic of Korea and South and China has been very important. So I guess my point is, I agree that China isn't there yet, but I think what we collectively are doing to develop this ROK-China relationship needs to continue. This needs to be a major focus of addressing the North Korean problem, that is the making sure the quality and even quantity of South Korean Chinese dialogue is enhanced.
Beth Shen, did you say
that? I feel that China is beginning to reassess the strategic value of North Korea to China. And I think they are more concerned than before about the collateral damage that North Korea is inflicting on China's security and their vital national security interests. All they want from North Korea is not to do harm to China's interests. And I don't think there's any positive thing that North Korea is able to do for China. I think that kind of subtle change in strategic thinking is occurring within the, I think, power elite and among the strategic thinkers in China. And they begin to attach greater strategic value to the ROK, to the relationship with ROK. Because for China, the value, strategic value of the ROK is increasing while North Korea's value is decreasing. So this is, I think, I don't know how this new assessment of the relative strategic values between South and North to China is going to lead to their future policy toward the Korean Peninsula. I don't know how that will lead up to, but I think there is a subtle change going on in their thinking. And but I don't think we can expect an important vital role from China in denuclearizing North Korea. They still want two mutually contradictory things. They want both stability of regime. They have a very narrow comfort zone with regard to North Korea. They don't want to see any disruptions in their social stability in the border region, no massive outflow of refugees to destabilize the bordering regions. So at the same time, they want denuclearization. I don't think these two goals can go together. I don't think they are going to make a choice.
Between them. Although the administration's rhetoric would suggest they still want them to make a choice. Steve, you had a point?
Well, yes, I fundamentally agree with that. But there are, I think, two or three major myths that trouble the policymaking process from the U.S. point of view and substitute for an actual policy toward North Korea. One is that North Korea is about to collapse. Well, that's been around for the last 25 years, and at some point, probably they will. But I don't know when, and I don't know under what circumstances, and that may not be, by that time, a good thing. So we have to deal with it as it is. The second myth that's, I think, all too pervasive is that if China really wanted to, they could solve this problem. And my own view is that China's fundamental dilemma regarding its interests is at least as profound as ours, probably more so. I wouldn't want to have to address China's long-term interests on the Korean Peninsula from a policy point of view. And remember, China has at least 3,000 years of history in dealing with the Korean Peninsula. They know what they really would like to see there. It's a question of how you bring it about. And I would, a prediction that will never have to be verified one way or another, I think, is that when the time comes that China thinks seriously about the future of North Korea, they're going to want to think seriously about the future of the Korean Peninsula. And that puts into question the nature of the U.S. relationship with South Korea and lots of other things. But to expect us to expect that China's going to make a discrete set of decisions affecting their relations with North Korea, I think it's just not going to happen.
Bob, if it's June, which is usually when Major League Baseball brings out sort of Old Timers Day, and you come out and you get to see everybody show up at the plate one more time. So if you were popped back in your old job 21 years later, don't flee from the stage, right?
Don't accept that premise.
Tell me what kind of strategy you think you would work out, both on the China side of this, if we take Steve's statement, which I think is right, that the Chinese have to think of a total Korean Peninsula strategy, and if you think about the sanctions element of it, and if you think about what incentives, if any, we want to go offer, which the Obama administration has basically offered none, following the Gates rule that they didn't want to sell the same horse again.
So if we can proceed from some other premise.
Other than Old Timers Day?
Other than Old Timers Day, yeah. But to speak to some of that, one, it has struck me, and I will look to my colleagues on left and right here, that it's very difficult to proceed with negotiations with the DPRK if the stars are not aligned in terms of domestic politics, and dare I say it, in the Republic of Korea, North Korea, and the United States. If for whatever passes for domestic politics in North Korea, if whatever the regime thinks it needs to do is inconsistent with negotiations with the United States of America, they're not going to happen. It's very hard for the United States to proceed if the Republic of Korea, the domestic politics there, are not supportive. I have some experience with that in the days of Kim Il-sung, and they didn't preclude negotiations, but let's say there was an edge. And certainly in this country, if an administration believes it takes great moral courage to engage North Korea because of all the comments that come charging, submitting to blackmail and naivete, et cetera. In other words, if you cannot get the domestic support for discussions to proceed, it's very hard to believe that you can engage. So that's and I think sometimes that's been the problem, certainly for the United States of America. Second point is, I think you very much need to understand and be persuasive about why we need to engage the North, because it's so unpleasant to do so. In other words, you've got to be persuasive on the point that, to put it in a negative, that Secretary Powell many years ago had it wrong. When Secretary Powell was asked on a Sunday morning show about what he was going to do about North Korea, he said nothing. Why do we care? What are they going to do with their nuclear weapons? Are they going to eat them? You know, how does this change?
He said you can't eat plutonium, right?
Among other things, and indeed he's right. You really shouldn't eat plutonium. But the point is that the North Korean program is not benign. As it sits there, it's at least a political provocation to the non-nuclear weapon status of both South Korea and Japan. It is there is the possibility of transfer, and it turned out that, in fact, the North Koreans did transfer important nuclear technology to a country that was once a country called Syria, and that transfer was a very bad precedent. It also happens that the ballistic missile program is a cause of anxiety in Japan and elsewhere. So And we add to that North Korean behavior, which can be provocative and in fact escalate into a conventional conflict, if not more than that. So you have to be persuasive, it seems to me, that there is a reason for engaging the North, that to bring them down. And you also have to have the North Koreans engage in a way that, as we said before, more than one of us, suggests that they'd be prepared to give up this nuclear weapons program, or else it doesn't seem to me to make a lot of sense. That's a lot of ifs to get by, and it's also an argument that has to be made that this problem does not get better, as they used to say, like fine wine, by leaving it alone. You know, it's getting worse, and the projections of nuclear weapons capability by 2020 are...
Well, those projections are maybe 20 weapons, maybe more.
20 to 100, low, high.
Right.
I mean, it does not yet look like the Pakistani program, but it's beginning to look like a serious nuclear weapons program rather than what you might call a demonstration capability. And that will be troubling to a strategic vision of the region. I completely agree with my colleagues about China, certainly to the extent that we have put, particularly the United States, has put this weight in arguing that this should be China's problem. And I can't believe that's the right answer. The Chinese have a view of this, which there is a consistency between our outcomes and outcomes they want, but they're not congruent. The Chinese have huge concerns about instability on the Korean Peninsula and what would happen in a collapse. And I don't whether they have the capability to cause the collapse. They don't have the will to do that because they see outcomes that can be very difficult to manage. So I think we can look to the Chinese for help in these matters at critical points, but we can't outsource the problem.
Okay. We have a little bit of time for some questions from the audience. So why don't we start right back here with this gentleman. And he's got a microphone coming. And if you can keep the question short, tell us who you are.
Great. Scott Faulkner with the One Korea Coalition. A couple months ago, Wired Magazine talked about the smuggling of thumb drives into the North. And so what is your view of, is there a undercurrent of domestic turbulence, reform, questioning of the regime the same way we saw in the 1980s in Eastern Europe? Is there anything that can be done to maybe stir that pot?
Who wants to take that one up?
Well, I used to live in Eastern Europe in the 1980s. I like Eastern Europe as even then I liked it. I like it a lot more now. But North Korea really has very little to do with Eastern Europe. Or Eastern Europe is no North Korea. That said, there are some things happening in terms of information getting in, and we know that from refugee reporting that more information gets in than you think. I think one key issue would be if you saw, radios coming into North Korea must be fixed within a certain amount of time so that they only get a North Korean state signal. So if we could start seeing that system break down, that would indicate that they're kind of losing control. But we're not seeing that system break down at this point. The system of five families, and this goes way back into the regional culture, five families, one of whom has to kind of keep track of the others, that system is not breaking down. So far, we're not seeing the sort of breakdowns that we saw in Eastern Europe.
But we are seeing much more cell phone use along the Chinese border that has had
some kind of where they pick up the Chinese net.
Right.
Yeah, and it's clearly coming from relatives who give a relative a cell phone. So
right.
There's some of that, but not very much of it. But I guess the overall question is, should people continue to pass thumb drives? Should there be balloons full of information and things like that? I've never been opposed to it. I don't think the U.S. government should put itself in being opposed to it. I think to some extent the ROK has issues, where people in villages don't like to have their villages used as sort of propaganda or to send propaganda. Those are issues the Koreans need to take care of. But as far as I'm concerned, we should keep doing things where we can and see what is going on.
Let me flip that question in reverse direction and ask it to Ambassador Chun. So The most notable thing we've seen North Korea do in the American context in recent times is the Sony hack, if you believe that they were behind it. And that suggests that the North Korean government is seeing in cyber a weapon that they can actually use, which they can't do in the case of nuclear. And it also suggests that they've gotten significantly better at it than we had thought they were, even though if you read what's published in the New York Times, both South Korea and the United States were pretty deeply up inside the North Korean computer systems as early as 2010. So tell us a little bit about what you think the North Korean strategy is for the use of cyber as a weapon.
Well, we have seen, you know, how good they are in using their cyber capability to attack even American Sony Pictures. But you know, most people don't understand why North Korea is so good at that. I think the best scientific engineering talent in North Korea goes to either, you know, nuclear technology or cyber technology. So these are the most popular areas where North Korea's best talent, best scientific talent is employed. And you don't have many private companies in North Korea. No private company that can employ these best scientists, engineers in cyber technology. And all they can do is to be employed by the state. And all they can do, the best thing they can do is for cyber attack. So, but in other countries, in the Republic of Korea, elsewhere, the best, you know, experts in cyber technology, they will go to private sector. They are better paid there. And there are many other areas where they can, you know, get better jobs. But in North Korea, the best place for them is the military, the cyber attack industry. So that's why, even though cyber technology in general is far more backward than in any other countries, you know, if they can get the best talent in one area, they can do better in that area than many other countries. So that's one explanation I can give. So we shouldn't underestimate their capability. But in the end, in the future, if internet connections spread in North Korea, they will be more vulnerable than any country to cyber attack from other countries. So they can cut both ways in the future.
Right back here.
Thank you. Professor Wayne Glass from the University of Southern California here with a group of fighting young Trojans. I hope you get a chance to meet our young students during, maybe after the session. Great session, thank you very much. Bob, you talked about the domestic political stars lining up. I was in the Senate in those days, in the wake of the agreed framework, and it was my observation that the Congress was working as hard as they could to, in effect, undo many elements of the agreed framework. The Congress is in the business now of engaging the issue of this potential deal with Iran. I see the Congress as a key variable in this question of domestic political stars lining up. Lessons learned. That's one of them. Now, I hate to be the skunk at the picnic, but is there any hope in this regard?
Wayne, the first thing that occurs to me is that while there was with the, you know, it happens when there's a change in both houses, all the committee chairmanships change, and all those nice, friendly committee sessions you had are not so friendly anymore as the party that's not in control of the White House is now in control of the Congress. But it wasn't let's undo the framework. It was because they could actually have done some things that would have made it very difficult. They kept funding those transfers that we needed to make to implement the framework. They wanted to, in fact, criticize.
For those who don't remember, those were transfers of oil.
heavy fuel oil, principally, and support keto. Some things that needed to be done. So that there was, and to go back to Chris's comment, there was an awareness among the Republicans and the Senate and the House that they didn't have anything to replace the agreed framework with, as much as they really didn't like the agreed framework, but I think philosophically and because it was the other party's administration. So they didn't do as badly towards it as they might. However, when you look, you fast forward, enough people have noticed that the political atmosphere, which wasn't terrific in the middle 90s, has gone from not being terrific to being horrendous. And that if a leader in the Senate can say our objective is to bring down the president and oppose everything the president wants to do, you know your days are going to be pretty long. And it makes this the proposition I've put on the table before, that you need domestic support, makes it really a lot harder. The Iranian case is going to be interesting, I'm sure, and instructive to the administration as it plausibly continues to explore the possibility of doing something more with North Korea. If there's a, if you will, a fair shake here and just a tough look at the deal with Iran as it emerges this month, that's one thing. If it is no, because it has been negotiated by the administration, then it makes it very much more difficult, it seems to me.
Okay, time is running a little bit tight. We'll take the young lady right here.
My name is Kayla Orta. In 2013, Bosworth and Gallucci, you wrote an article in the New York Times, the International New York Times. It was titled Reasons to Talk to North Korea. And in the article, you talk about how we shouldn't have no talks for talk's sake, and you talk about how we should engage North Korea. It's been 2 years now, and I'm curious to see, do you think our current policy stance has changed? Are we addressing North Korea better? Or are a lot of the things you still talked about in that article still true today?
Quickly, no. No, I don't think that our current approach has changed very much at all. I think we continue to be enamored with the concept of strategic patience, whatever that means. And I understand these problems are extremely difficult. They're politically contentious. The administration only has 2 years left. Its agenda is very full, particularly with regard to Iran. And should we be expecting that they're going to pick up and do something forward-looking on North Korea? I don't think so.
How about the flip side of that? Could they be forced into a crisis with a missile long-range missile launch that actually worked, clear evidence that they could shrink a nuclear weapon that could fit on top of these?
May I?
Sure.
That's not a, in my view...
It's not a strategic approach by any means.
No, it's not a hook for negotiations. It's a hook for sanctions. In other words, what works in this country is not to go into a negotiation because you were pressured to do it.
Right.
In matter of fact, after something like that happens, what someone will say in the administration, don't know who, someone will say, well, that means we have to postpone our initiative another 6 months to sort of let the juices that have run out a little bit. So I mean, I agree entirely with what Steve just said in answer to your question, but I think the structure is exactly the opposite. We don't respond to the pressure of others by deciding it's a good time to go into negotiation. It's a bad time.
But of course, the North Koreans, based on some previous experiences, might think that those tests actually would force the U.S. into
or not. I mean, I don't think so.
You don't believe so?
I don't think. I agree with Chun Young Woo in the beginning of this panel that I don't see the political will in North Korea to pursue negotiations. And so until they give some private sign that they would like negotiations, that they are prepared to deal with negotiations with, as Bob said, with the nuclear program on the table, I think it's very hard to get into negotiations.
And, but we can't seem to want it more than they do.
Yeah, I mean, just you know, you can't buy a rug that way. I mean, you certainly can't get a nuclear deal that way. So I think we need to think not just of negotiations, but as a broader strategy that includes negotiations, that includes thickening up of missile defense in the region, that includes an effort to work with six parties, not necessarily on the negotiations, but on various other sharing mechanisms. I mean, as Chun Young-woo said, everything we say about North Korea is an educated guess. So let's see what can be done to improve that educated guessing to some partial knowledge. And I think that can be done with more sharing. So I think the six parties offer a framework for this. But I think we need to look at negotiations as an element in a broader strategy.
We'll have time for one more, and we'll take the young lady right here. Thank you. Microphone's coming to you.
Hi, my name is Jackie Kim. I'm a research intern for the Human Rights Committee for North Korea, and I'm also from University of Southern California, although I'm not with that group. Thank you so much for your conversation. I had a really good time listening to it. So I just want to direct everyone's attention to what Dr. Campbell said in the first panel. He talked about how the issue of human rights in North Korea is always like sidestepped, and I think that's very true. We hear stories about defectors or POWs, and we sympathize with them for like 5 minutes, you know, when they're talking or we're reading their story, but after that, we just kind of forget about them. And when the world looks at North Korea now, we look at the nuclear weapons they're using or the regime of Kim Jong-un, and we fail to notice the people that are actually suffering under him. And the reason why the world looks at North Korea and views it as not as a country, but as like the enemy of the world and like a very inhuman state, I guess it's because of the nuclear weapons, because of Kim Jong-un, I agree. But however, I think North Korea should be viewed as an inhuman state because of the people who are suffering. So what are your views on how to put human rights as a, you know, first priority in all the negotiations that are happening around the world? And how do you make North Korea become human again? Like, how do you make the world view North Korea as a human country?
Well, let's try that in a slightly different way, which is, even should human rights be the first item, as she's suggesting, or not?
Let me just say that during my time, we had a six-party process aimed at nuclear disarmament. We put everything on the table. We're prepared to normalize relations. We're prepared to do everything. In the context of normalizing relations, let's say we got a commitment from the North Koreans not only to disable, but also to dismantle and ultimately abandon all their nuclear programs. And then we moved on with our effort, requirement, which was to normalize. In the context of any normalization with any dictatorship out of the cold, we would have a track dealing with human rights. No question we'd have that track. But the idea to say, well, we've got this problem of nuclear weapons, so let's just add human rights to it, since we can't seem to solve nuclear weapons. I doubt we'll solve human rights, but it'll sound better if we put it all together. I don't think that's serious strategy. I think the strategy should be get the nuclear problem under control, that is, living up to the September agreement of abandoning it, create the process for moving forward with normalization, and in the context of normalization, as we've done with many other countries, we have a human rights track. So that, I think that was the right approach. The problem is not us, the problem is the North Koreans.
Anybody else on that? Pastor Chung?
Well, since we are running out of time, I would like to go back to the question of what to do with the North Korean nuclear program, earlier question. And and there was a question about whether we should re-engage North Korea. I believe that diplomacy still remains the best way to denuclearize. But if we are going to give a chance to diplomacy, I don't think we can just beg North Korea to come back to the Six Party. That will not work unless we restructure the interest for North Korea in a way that can induce them into denuclearization. I don't think the diplomacy will work. We have to create political energy to make diplomacy work and to strengthen the hand of diplomacy. I think we cannot just do that with the current sanctions in place. Ambassador Bosworth said earlier that North Korea is less vulnerable to sanctions. That's one of the reasons why sanctions don't work. I think another reason is that U.S. doesn't have the same kind of political will to really impose sanctions that work for North Korea, because sanctions are not, the current sanctions are not structured to change North Korea's strategic calculations. So under the current sanctions that favors North Korea's nuclear armament, that would encourage North Korea's nuclear armament with impunity, that if we are going to retain those kind of sanctions, which will not really, you know, bite North Korea, I don't think diplomacy will work.
So could economic sanctions do that, or do you need to actually start cutting off shipments in and out of the country, physically cut them off, if you're really going to make
something? I think there are still many other ways, that unexplored ways, we can further pressure North Korea into changing their strategic calculus. Without that happening, I think begging North Korea back to the six-party talks alone, that, and we can re-engage them, but without tougher sanctions that can change North Korea's decision, strategic decision, and their behavior, I don't think this, even if we resume the six-party talks, they will go anywhere. That's, I think, Sid Seiler's job to do in the future. But
Stephen, Bob, last thoughts on this?
A couple of things very quickly. One, I agree entirely with Chris about how to, the only approach I think is feasible with regard to the question of human rights. I am appalled by the situation in North Korea. Any thinking human being has to be appalled by that. But you're not going to deal with it by focusing everything on that, saying, we're going to get rid of that problem, then we'll move on to other problems. It's not the key. Secondly, I think looking ahead, we have to go back to the principles of the September 2005 joint statement, which clearly establish an agenda beyond denuclearization. I think one of our principal difficulties has been that we focus very heavily, almost exclusively, on denuclearization. That costs questions of support on the questions of human rights, but it also is not a very attractive agenda to the North Koreans. They want to demonstrate, us to demonstrate what else we're prepared to do. And the joint statement with its four goals, I think, sets that forth very clearly. Whether it's best done within a six-party framework or not, I don't really care. The issue is not the nature of the framework. The question is, how do we approach what should be comprehensive negotiations? The North Korean threat is most manifestly a nuclear weapons threat. But North Korea's, for me, North Korea's real threat is its pronounced weakness. It's a failed state right at the heart of the most dynamic political, economic region of the world. And that gives them an importance that the rest of us simply cannot deny. And I don't think you deal with that just by focusing on the manifestation of that threat, which at the moment tends to be the nuclear program.
Bob, you get the last word.
two quick points as the last word. One, I could get enthusiastic about more effective sanctions, but I wouldn't want to get too enthusiastic unless I were also prepared to deal with consequences that might go kinetic, as they say these days. So that understand that you don't do this as a freebie. You can't just turn the screws and be certain that there will not be an escalation that'll follow from that. I'm not saying don't do it, but you'd better be prepared in every sense, and that means with your ally, South Korea, and your other ally, Japan, with the Chinese understanding this and certainly having a domestic support. That's all I'll say on the question of escalating sanctions. On the human rights question, first of all, 1994 was then, and this is now. In 1994, with all respect to the human rights community, I avoided them because then it was plausible to have an agreement with North Korea which ignored the atrocities of human rights in North Korea. And my goal, my objective given to me by a president, was to do something about the nuclear weapons program. Not, incidentally, the conventional weapons program, not anything else other than the nuclear weapons program. But that was then.
Now, I think, if I can extract from what my two colleagues on either side of me said, if there's going to be an agreement with North Korea, it is not going to be just a nuclear agreement. It's going to be a comprehensive agreement. And if there's a comprehensive agreement that includes a treaty of peace, that includes all kinds of other things, that's entirely implausible to impossible to envision without addressing the human rights issue. So I would say, don't worry, we're not going to do what we did in 1994. We can't. We shouldn't. That will be part of this. It will also, if you remember in the previous panel, human rights was a vector of attack with North Korea. That may or may not be a wise thing to do, but I'm pretty confident that if we do have a comprehensive agreement, human rights will be a serious part of it.
Well, I thank you very much. This is a great panel. I enjoyed talking with all of you. Victor, do you have some last words for us?
No, I too want to reiterate David's thanks. I think it was a fantastic panel. The whole morning's been great. Thank you all for coming. Thank you to especially our Korean guests from coming from so far. And we look forward to seeing you at the next event here at CSIS. So this meeting is adjourned. Thank you.